Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to another episode of Oxygen Not Included on our Max Colonization series. Today, we begin a project of epic proportions. Well, I say epic, but it's all got to fit in this little area right here. And it's going to be a dual-purpose project. First, we're going to have geothermal heat coming up through here, heating a hot plate that will serve our eventual petroleum boiler. Second, we're going to use geothermal energy to also provide power for a bunch of steam turbines along with taming this volcano. And the tricky part is we're going to try to do it with one source of geothermal power. And it kind of stinks that I have to put it in this position, but with this volcano here, it really is the best location on the map. We're going to have to move all these rails again, all these gas pipes, even the power if we want to make sure everything stays nice and clean. So prep work on this project is taking a little while. We've managed to reroute all of our power, even though it kind of looks disgusting. All of the vents have been moved. We've saved a few because we're going to need to vacuum out quite a bit. And then we even moved our rail systems. And now I think it's time for the initial design with the insulated tiles. Now this is going to be really hard to visualize for a while, but it comes down to it. We're going to have two compartments. This one, which is going to be our petroleum boiler, and this one that's going to be geothermal power. Now the power spike's going to come from the same spot and feed into two different directions. This direction here, feeding up to the hot plate for our petroleum boiler. This direction over here, feeding the hot plate for the geothermal power. There will be two entrances, which is sort of required because they will be separated. This one here, leading to a vacuumed out space for the petroleum boiler. And then this one over here, that'll be a giant steam room. Now we won't need to get in here too much. And then this one here, which is going to be filled with steam. Now this one's not gonna stay here forever. Once we build in the guts of how the geothermal power is going to come in through this side, we'll be able to close this all up. It seems like Jack Dyde has been put into some precarious situations in the last couple of episodes. This one, I'm still confused. I'm guessing they deconstructed a fire pole coming down here and just didn't realize they needed a way to go back up. Now, considering this project is going to have a lot of moving parts, the smart thing would have been to go over to a test map, put in all the guts, and test it out. But like I said, that was the smart thing, and we're not concerned with that sort of thing on this channel. After all, chaos is always going to find a way, so we might as well help it along. And once again, it is Jack Dyde. The good news, they have plenty of oxygen to breathe. The bad news is they've managed to completely block themselves in. So I think in this case, it is two deconstructs and they escape once again with their life. So here's our first liquid lock, and this is the temporary one. Or I sure hope so, because it's not going to be a great liquid lock. We're just going to rely on a few dabs of oil to run down this little line, and that way we can vacuum this whole area out. This might be the number one dumbest idea I've had in this episode yet, because we're going to be breaking into the magma core and relying on these little three beads of oil to prevent all this atmosphere from running on in. This liquid lock I'm less concerned about. It's going to last the test of time. We're going to fill it to the brim with a bunch of crude oil. And like we said before, this is all going to be a vacuum permanently, so it's not going to transfer any heat or anything. Well, unless we mess something up and this becomes a sour gas boiler, and then we're just pretty much in deep trouble. We need to seal it off and never, ever reopen it again. That ought to do it. It looks like the perfect amount of oil. And the great vacuum has started. We're using four gas pumps, so it shouldn't take any time at all. As for the petroleum boiler, this is going to be our heat shaft. Right now, it's 3 tiles wide, as I wanted to show you the difference between gold, steel, and aluminum. Gold is the longtime favorite with a thermal conductivity 60 and a specific heat capacity of 0.12. Next up is steel with a thermal conductivity of 54 and a specific heat capacity of 0.49. But then we have aluminum. Aluminum looks at the other metal tiles and says, hey, hold my beer. It has a thermal conductivity of 205 and a specific heat capacity of 0.91. Unfortunately, it only has a melting point of 660. And you can see, crude oil turns into petroleum at 400 degrees. That doesn't give us a lot of play to make sure that this door shuts fast enough before boiling this petroleum. The argument could be made for gold because of its higher melting point and its a little bit higher thermal conductivity, but the specific heat capacity in gold really takes it away. So I think in this case, we're going to be using steel. Knowing that we could have gotten away with aluminum, But if you've ever built a petroleum boiler before, the heat's going to come rushing in, we're going to close off the vacuum, and that temperature tends to spike a little bit before the automation can kick in, telling that door to shut. So to play it safe, we're going to use steel. It's always amazed me how duplicants can build doors through solid objects. We're almost done with our vacuuming here. We're doing a couple of more tests on material types. You can see the vacuum over here is completely done. It's just the weird little angles and cuts here make it a little bit longer of a process. Some of you may wonder why I'm not using diamonds up here and instead opting to use the steel. Because if you look at the diamond, it's got a thermal conductivity of 80 and a specific heat capacity of 0.51. Better than the steel metal tiles across the board. Well, truth be told, I'd love to. But I only have 7 tons of diamond left. And we're going to use them for a situation over here as well. We are just about done with this vacuum. The only little bit left is here. We may have to put another pump in here or just wait an incredibly long time for all this to work out. But it does mean that we can start drilling down into this magma biome. And fingers crossed, nothing's going to mess up. But just in case, let's, you know, save. So here's the plan. Now, I put plan in quotes because the plan's only going to last until we touch the magma, and then, you know, magma's going to decide to do what magma's going to do. All of this magma contains a ton of heat, and we want to tap into that heat. The issue is you want to be able to tap deep enough to get as much heat as possible and allow this magma more area to interact with. And normally, we use a diamond window tile heat spike. We're going to do the same this time, except the spike is going to come right down through here. And the reason why is because we're then going to connect that spike to both the petroleum boiler and the geothermal power area. Well, I guess no time is as good as the present, right? Good luck, have fun. We're also going to put in the final separation in between the petroleum boiler and the geothermal power center. Just in case things go horribly bad, I'd rather it only happen to one side, not both. We're getting really close to the belly of the beast. All this abyssalite is very, very hot. So we're going to be very selective on which abyssalite we take out of here. And it doesn't look like any of this abyssalite is leaving anytime soon. Ooh, this one can go. Now time for the really stupid part. It's time to build the doors that will allow us to burrow all the way through here. To start off with, we're going to need to open this up a little bit. Now, there are other ways to do this, but what I think we're going to try is just open it up just low enough to where we can start pushing the magma down with the doors as we build these diamond temperature window tiles here and here. The problem is going to be the magma pressure. Right here, it says 1,637 kilos. I believe that's not a lot of pressure, so I don't think it'll overflow, but I think and I believe aren't normally a part of the best laid plans. In fact, why don't we get rid of one piece of abyssalite? Let's see how well this does. The goal is to get one door in here to start with, and hopefully be able to corner build it, and that way no magma is allowed to shoot up. Okay, this could be worse. It's only a half a ton of magma, no big deal. And once again, Carol's doing the build a door through the abyssalite trick. Had I thought there was a chance of them doing that, I would have done it. Now we gotta deal with just a little bit of magma. Now, Jack doesn't understand that he's standing inside of magma. He believes it's okay and he's just gonna carry on with the rest of his life. But what we're trying to do is get it just small enough to where we can mop it. And then we can have little bottles worth of magma. Now, the science behind this, it's blurry. You know, they're really well-reinforced bottles. But now, we have our successful spike began because, as you remember, we can build a door through this door. Now, all we have to do is lock this door, we'll unlock this one, and we'll be able to stand on top of this one. We're also going to take an opportunity to use this magma for good, not evil. We're going to dump it right into here, where we'll eventually be able to use it to start our sort of steam bath. Hopefully nothing will go wrong, right, Patrick? While the dupes are coming over here to lock and unlock these doors, I canceled the construction of these window tiles for one reason. I don't want them to come down through here and then have this door unlock as they're attempting to build these window tiles. That would end very badly for us because all this magma would come shooting out. Because now we've compressed the magma. You can see we're already up to over 2 tons per tile. It would be a bad day for us. Oh, I am really nervous. Oh, that feels better. As the duplicants continue to work on this, I figured it's about time to go over the basics of the petroleum boiler just in case you haven't seen one. We're going to grab all this crude oil. Now let's not get excited, it's not going to be that much, because as we've said frequently, there's just not a lot of slicksters here. We could perhaps grow them one day, but for now, this is what we have. And then we're going to send the oil all the way down here. Now to start off with, the oil is just going to snake all the way up, more on that in a little bit, and then drop onto this hot pan here. This is our boilerplate. If you remember, crude oil turns into petroleum at 399 degrees. So all the heat being generated through this spike is going to transfer into these metal steel tiles up to about 402 degrees and then start flashing this crude oil. The petroleum it forms will continuously build all the way to the top of this lip. Now the size of this basin is important because all of this petroleum is going to be holding precious heat. The bigger your basin, the more stable the boiler can be. But then the petroleum, when it hits this lip, is going to start flowing down through here. Now this is the important part. These pipes form what we call a counterflow heat exchanger. Remember, this is where we're bringing all of our crude oil in. That crude oil is going to be pretty cold, but all this petroleum is going to be 400 and something degrees. So what it's going to do is slowly heat up all the crude oil in the pipes. That way, by the time it finally drips out of this liquid vent, it already only needs another degree or two in order to fully flash into petroleum. Now this process normally takes some fiddling around with these pipes here. You need to figure out, hey, do I need to go and add some more insulated tiles just to get the temperature just right? Now this may even be too many levels. I went a little taller than I'm used to for the simple fact that I'm not as wide on the petroleum boilers. My petroleum boilers are normally about this wide. So we're stacking it a little bit higher, so we're definitely going to have to play around with those temps. But Echo, why are we doing this to begin with when the developers gave us the oil refinery? Well, that's just it. Not only does the oil refinery cost 480 watts in power, but it also only converts 50% of that crude oil into petroleum. The rest becomes natural gas. So for the cost of 120 watts to control this door and 240 watts in order to pump, we're going to be able to get 100% of the petroleum in return for any amount of crude oil that we put into it, so long as our heat source holds up, which it will for a few thousand cycles. Just when everything was going absolutely well, we've decided to blow this lock here and fill this entire chamber with sour gas. Now it's just micrograms, so we should be able to take care of it, but we definitely need to get some more crude oil down here, and I mean really quickly. Okay, which one of you stole the igneous rock? My guess is some of this oil somehow made it all the way down here, because all that magma turned into igneous rock, except now all the igneous rock is gone, and that feels better already. We lost our little bit of magma, and somebody ran away with all the igneous rock, so I'm sure I'll hear a scalding message sometime in the near future, or a broken building. By the time the petroleum gets all the way down here, it should be sufficiently cooled. In fact, it should be almost the same as the source crude oil, and in this case, it's 66 degrees. Well, at least right now. But I figured, why to stop there? So we're going to send it through, once again, another debris chiller, except it's not going to be alone. We also have rails that are going to be going through here, because it's going to be collecting all the cobalt from this volcano. First, the cobalt's going to travel down here and get to deposit all of its heat that it can in the effort to generate more power from these steam turbines. But those steam turbines are also going to be supplemented by a heat injector system using a door similar to how this is working. So change one has already occurred. We're going to be replacing all these igneous rock temperature shift plates. Where I failed is their melting point's at 1409. I thought we'd be drawing enough heat, but especially with here in the beginning, we're not going to have any sort of environment to transfer the heat. I realized it when I put them down here and they instantly turned into magma. My bad, that one's on me. So we're going to be using some obsidian temperature shift plates to be able to transfer in between these diamond window tiles. And then I also failed to realize this one piece of neutronium right here. The idea was I was going to spend diamond window tiles all the way up on this side, but I can't connect them because of this right here. So we're going to make this awkward sort of window brick here. Whether or not this is effective, who knows. But before I can even think about continuing, I need to wait for this place to vacuum out. It's almost there. It's got micrograms, but yet it's still hot enough to make some dupes scald if they sit in it too long. So in case you're wondering what we've been up to, well, we're going through the very, very long process to re-vacuum out this room. It still isn't a vacuum. I really should have put in a better liquid lock. I know better, but yet, do I really know better? Because I keep doing this. This'll break, let a bunch of carbon dioxide rush in, and then I'll be like, oh, I know what I'll do. I'll put a little bit more crude oil down on it. We used to have so much good, qualified, duplicate labor, and now all they want to do is lay down in their triage cots. Morale will not improve until we get the job done. It's only 1,000+ degrees, and it's milligrams. We are finally vacuumed out again. Work can commence. Now in the heyday, we've managed to make a mess. And then I made the mess worse by making the automation wires to fix the mess out of cobalt. I could have sworn I selected steel, but the game insisted I selected cobalt. But we have a trick for this. All we do is lock this door, and then we simply shut this door using automation. And goodbye, magma. So now when we open it back up, the magma's magically gone. The good news, though, is we're almost there. I'm gonna keep putting down some obsidian temperature shift plates and then start to build our diamond spike. I was also considering just filling this entire room up with steam and allowing the steam to be the environment that the temperature shift plates would transfer with. But then I realized I'm eventually gonna wanna get back in here to extend this. It probably wouldn't be such a good idea to fill this chamber here with steam. So we'll keep it a vacuum, but we'll connect these window tiles here, and then we're going to connect the set here. In fact, we don't need that there. I've been waiting for this cobalt volcano to go dormant, for it must be 30 cycles. I've built a couple of steel metal tiles here to try to lower the temp, but the volcano keeps erupting, so it's kind of pointless. Once we finally see a dormant state on the volcano, we can turn this all back into debris, and then we'll finally be able to analyze the volcano. Oh, when am I gonna learn? Not this episode, that's for sure. The good news is I already sealed this up so we can finally get in here and finish the work for the boiler, because this is maintained perfect vacuum. What's happening is people are taking some of the hot debris, thinking that they need it, and then dropping it right in here. Very inconsiderate out of the dupes. I would love to know why they keep asking for igneous rock. We're not using igneous rock anywhere out here. Yet they keep trying to grab it. A couple of updates around the colony while we wait for that room to vacuum out again for some reason. There are now 230 slicksters in this room. The thing that stinks is we still don't have infinite food storage. So all these calories are going to start going off, turn into rot pile and then polluted dirt. The good news for us is that just means more oxygen, because we have all the polluted dirt and rot piles going right down in here. Either way, it'd still be nice that by the time this all turned into meat, because the oil level raised up to the doors and the slicksters couldn't go anywhere anymore, that we'd have infinite food storage. Maybe we'll get around to a kitchen renovation next episode. This episode, I don't believe the dupes are too happy with me to do another project. I can't imagine why. Look, kids, it's Big Ben. We have a vacuum again. I know, it's a pretty big deal to me too. The last few pieces of sour gas are finally, and they're gone. Well, almost. We need to get that little guy too. And unfortunately, the volcano is still laughing at me. It's also super compressed. I don't know why it just wouldn't raise in another level, but apparently the density of cobalt allows it to have 3 tons of liquid cobalt in one tile. As surprised as I am, we're getting ready to start this petroleum boiler. Now I'm... oh no. Well, it's happened again. What is that? Number 3 this time? This time we're gonna try to help the matter by putting a manual airlock in the way. It's only a few grams of carbon dioxide, but unfortunately it keeps us out of here for a couple of cycles until the gas pumps finish vacuuming it out again. There is igneous rock, abyssalite, and that's about it in here. I guess there's the odd gold piece, but there's no reason they should be taking anything out of here to be able to drop into these little crude oil piles. I'm sure it's some debris. I'm just not sure what they're doing with it. The good news, though, is other than this steel sweep, I guess that could have been what we dropped in there? Leftovers of building materials? Do you know how rare it would have to be for them to grab this one piece of steel, and the only place they couldn't drop it was in these two tiles? And yet they still managed to figure it out. It couldn't have been these tiles, because I mopped those up once we're done, Anyways, before I was rudely interrupted by a liquid lock bursting again, as soon as this little bit of steel is gone, we're going to be able to seal this area up. We have diamond window tiles providing heat for the petroleum boiler, and then we're going to have the same window tiles sealing this area. In fact, we'll probably just use metal tiles here and here, and that way we'll be able to control the vacuum with this mechanized airlock, so when we need more heat in this steam room, we'll be able to add it. And that heat is just going to drive these steam turbines whenever we need it. Once this is all sealed up, we're going to put a battery right here, and it's going to be set low, something like 50-30. And that way, it should be an extra almost 3 kilowatts worth of power whenever we need it, which is normally when the natural gas is empty, such as now. As for the mega debris chiller, yep, that's going to be a new name. We're going to be filling it with aluminum metal tiles this time. Even though that we kind of proved that the polluted water is a little bit better, you can see the polluted water here is still at minus 0.6. These metal tiles are above zero, but we don't have an infinite supply of polluted water, and that's an awfully large debris chiller, so we're going to stick to the metal tiles this time. The only place that won't have metal tiles will be sort of around the valve and the temperature sensors. I really hope I got all this plumbing right the first time. Doesn't seem like a very likely thing, but there's always hope. I say things like I hope, and then I expect a 300 gram puddle of... Uh-oh. Oh, there it was. Look at that. Eric was standing here with the steel, and it caused it to flash right before our eyes. It should be the last piece of debris we have to take out of here, so one more time for the Gipper. Well, I guess that solves the mystery, though. Even when the debris isn't dropped by the duplicant, just the debris being carried by a duplicant can cause that small amount to flash. Learning stuff new every day. On the upside, that steel's down to 47 degrees now. We have found another rancher. This one has three skills. Combining with the husbandry, they're also good at cuisine and athletics, which is a great bonus for us. Their only negative is they're unempathetic. Not that we need doctors in this colony anyways. Welcome to our next duplicate, Doritos P. Good luck. Second verse, the same as the first. We have a vacuum again, and this time we've even sealed it up here as well. Huh? Now we're using our noggin. And before we break our vacuum again, we're going to go ahead and put our tiles here. A couple of steel tiles right there. And as I alluded to earlier, we saved enough diamond to do two diamond temperature shift plates just to help get it spread. We're actually nearing completion of the steam room. The last thing we have to do is clean up, but there is no way I'm taking all these hot metals through the front door. I think we've kind of learned our lesson on that. I don't know. So what we're going to do is we're going to put a steel automatic dispenser right here. We're going to drop everything in the room right here. When this whole thing fills with steam, all those metals and debris will then re-solidify, and then we'll dump them into a conveyor loader and they can join the rest of the loop. To do that, we're going to do sweep only and all and make it the largest priority so the duplicants would prefer to bring the stuff here. And then we're going to keep a watchful eye to make sure that they do. We're now down to the very last step. Well, other than picking up these bottles. And that is getting rid of the gas pumps and the gas pipes. Now, needless to say, if this goes wrong, I have to reinstall the pumps. And that's not going to exactly be friendly because I plan on filling this entire room with steam. The good thing is none of this debris should be hot. Should. Well, other than this one piece of abyssalite, but we're not going to sweep it up anymore. All right, I'm really pushing my luck, but I just got to get this cobalt volcano analyzed. We're about 10% there. We've managed to drop off most of the debris. We're going to finish vacuuming out the steam room one more time, and that's it. I may even leave this gas pump in there. We did manage to get the cobalt volcano completely analyzed, so I figured it's high in time to get this petroleum boiler going. Now, these plates are at 275 degrees. You can't have this door shut when that first petroleum hits. Otherwise, you're guaranteed to flash it. We have a liquid valve here that we're going to set on a very small amount. Remember, we're only going to be producing a half a kilo per second of crude oil based on the number of slicksters we have. So let's start it off with something even lower than that. A quarter kilo per second. Then all we have to do is connect our pipes here and the oil will start flowing. and the oil will begin to long trek all the way down to the petroleum boiler. The reason why it's imperative that you start off slow and you make sure that this doesn't instant flash any of your crude oil is because it definitely will. We're going to wait until there's at least 2 tiles worth of crude oil before we even turn this thing on. That way there's enough of a liquid to absorb the very fast temperature fluctuations that we'll see out of these metal tiles. Otherwise, we're going to fill this room with sour gas, and then I'm going to go to bed in tears tonight. It is exciting, though, watching the crude oil go through it for the very first time. Now, you can see the crude oil is making its way right now at 45 degrees. It's not going to be 45 degrees for long. The reason why this is such a touchy process is because petroleum flashes around 539 degrees. When it does flash, it turns into sour gas, and then you have all sorts of problems on your hand. Now, if we ever need to get in here to do maintenance, we'll be able to go through this door. For now, we're not letting anybody in. You'll also notice that I built it 2 tiles high, and that way I do have the available space to do that maintenance. But we're gonna let this go for a while and collect a lot more crude oil. That way there's enough mass to absorb all that temperature. We've managed to fill our basin here full of crude oil. We have a smidge of petroleum here that flashed when I was resetting this thermosensor. Not a big deal, but now's about the time that we want to start turning all this into petroleum before it overflows and starts our counterflow heat exchanger. So we're going to set it at 390 degrees just to start off with. 390 degrees not hot enough to get the crude oil to flash, but we wanted to get it almost there. So we'll hit above, the door is shut, since the temperature is not above, and these metal tiles will start taking some of that temperature and transfer it into this temperature shift plate. Now we specifically put some slow transferring obsidian here, and that way it can only draw out the heat so fast, which gives our boiler plate a little bit more time to react. It also has to heat all of this crude oil. So I'm feeling safe now, so I say we'll set it at 405. So once this thermosensor gets to 405, it'll open the door, killing the temperature transfer. We had a couple of minor setbacks, but the petroleum boiler is working great. We had to add a second row of insulated tiles because the flashing here was causing pressure damage to these insulated tiles. I went back and looked at some of my other designs, and sure enough, I had 2 tiles right here for this boiler tank. But so far, the counterflow heat exchanger is working great. The crude oil comes in around 60 degrees, heads off to the tank at around 395, almost 400. So by the time it hits the boiler tank, it doesn't take anything for it to flash. And so far, no sour gas. The metal tile gets up to about 425, 450 whenever it flips. We have it set on above 405, and that seems to be the sweet spot right now. In other good news, our steam room is working. Now, this is what took me most of the time, because when I started dropping water in here, it took a lot of water hitting this plate and before it finally went over to here to this metal tile so it could start transferring that temperature. We also added another thermosensor just because this one's a little bit far away. So now we have both of them being able to tell this door to shut. We'll eventually have them set on both once we get enough steam pressure in here, but right now there's only 25 kilos over here and about 30 kilos over here. I'd rather see about 50 in here to be able to transfer all this heat around. Speaking of transferring the heat around, this rail is doing great. We have the same similar system that we've used in the other debris chillers. This side, its only responsibility is to get it down to 125 degrees. Just realized I'm not sure how I'm going to be able to do that considering this debris is abyssalite. And as you know, abyssalite has no thermal conductivity. So we might have to let that through just to let all the other debris go through. But the other debris goes through just fine. You can see we have sedimentary rock, we have some igneous rock. And right now it's set on, if it's below 25, let it out. You can see we got a nice little stack here. Looks like some of the abyssalite did make it through. It must have been during a power outage. Those are still happening. We're also going to slowly crank this temperature up to be able to generate us more power. But I wanted to make sure that we had enough steam pressure in here. That way we didn't fry everything in the process. Because when this door shuts, it lets in a lot of heat very quickly. But I'm going to keep working on it in the background. We also have all of our petroleum coming in through here. Now, the counterflow heat exchanger does a decent job getting it down to about 59 degrees, but we're not letting it through until it's under 25. And that's all being controlled by this thermosensor here, which is set at 15 degrees. And all that petroleum is being dropped off right up here. Now, we've only got about 600 kilos so far, but it'll keep growing. Eventually, we'll have to make a bigger tank, but considering we're only running 250 grams per second, it's gonna be a while. This episode took me way too long, and it's because this whole system I probably should have separated into two episodes like I told you I was going to. But I was like, oh, they seem like relatively small projects. And without the issues, they would have been. Well, I hope you had a great time in this episode and are looking forward to more in this series. We're only about a dozen in, and we're still only on 2.5 planetoids. Needless to say, this one's probably going to take us 30, 40 episodes. Who knows? Either way, I'm glad to be able to share it with you. That's all for now, and I'll talk to you soon.